Just, you know, when I said we'd do it, do the interview, I said, you know, I had to say she was our favourite.
Lulu's our favourite.
Sorry, I know, but I was in a position. I couldn't say Lulu.
Here, finally. Sorry, but...
Yes?
Yeah. Hi. No, I'm actually here.
I'm waiting for someone.
Oh. I'm on my chair. I think it could be. Could be.
Michael, she's more a beehive. Look.
Yes,
elbows.
Yes, she
elbows.
Is. Is that... Hang on, keep it talking.
Hello, hello. Hello.
Hello.
I say Martha's earrings.
Not completely sure. No. Try the test.
I'll do the test.
Hello, hello. How do you do?
Again, how?
By the way, you don't have to say you love me. Just be close at hand. You don't have to...
Stay forever.
Hello.
I
yes, oh, it's you. Good. You did it.
I
you.
Wish you got it.
Please
do.
Sit down. Dawn
Thanks.
French.
Ah, hello.
She'll be asking the questions and she'll be putting everything through me.
Why? I can answer for myself.
No, it's for safety. I don't want you answering any old question.
When that midnight choo-choo leaves for Alabama, I'll be right there, I've got my fare. When I see that hefty two-time porter man, I'll grab him by the collar and I'll holler, Alabama, Alabama, that's where you stop your train. That brings me back again, right back where I remain. I'll be feeling grand and I will be right there with bells when that old conductor yells, all aboard, all aboard, all aboard for Alabama.
Right, I'm kicking off with the questions now. The first one is quite a personal one.
It was not a personal question.
No, I always get those.
No, just, I'm open with it.
What is your favourite colour?
Hang on, I'll try. What is your favourite colour?
Vodka.
Vodka.
It's a musician.
When I said I needed you, you said you would always stay. It wasn't me who changed. And I'm left here on my own, that I have to follow you and beg you to come home. You don't have to say you love me, just be close and bad. You don't have to stay forever, I will understand.
When you were christened, did the vicar just say, I thee christen you Dusty? Is that what he called
you? No, honest to God, that came along later. My real name is Mary Isabel Catherine Bernadette O'Brien.
Liar!
Still was going to believe
that's
that.
Stupid.
That's stupid.
Yes.
I love the piano. I love the piano.
My parents had a pretty eclectic taste in music, and that rubbed off on my brother and I, in that my father was a classical nut. I mean, he worshipped Beethoven, and Beethoven was it. I never got into Beethoven. But he played the piano very slowly because he was reading it like this. And he, I mean, we would have quizzes when I was about nine. He would play pieces of music and I'd have to guess the composer. He'd also tap out notations on the back of my hand. But I had to know what that was. The piece of music by the timing of his fingers on the back of my hand.
Give me a P, I, A, and ooh, 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 I love to stop right beside in that bright for a height of baby grand.
The only other things he listened to apart from classical music, which I listened to on the radio all the time with him, was jazz, a certain amount of jazz, but different kinds. I mean, he liked Jelly Roll Morton. I was very But he also liked Peggy Lee, who you wouldn't really think of as jazz. Then she was considered a pop singer.
I know I could never sound like her, but I wanted to. She swung like crazy, and to this day, swings more naturally, and it all sounds so effortless.
Chicks were born to give you fever, be it Fahrenheit or centigrade, they give you fever.
But I also was very influenced by my brother, who was passionately in love with Carmen Miranda and kept drawing her shoes. He loved platform shoes. I don't know whether he wears them still, but he really, really did good drawings of them.
I expect you're very, very proud of your brother, Bruce Springsteen, aren't you?
What?
Bruce Springsteen, your brother.
My own brother, Thomas, hasn't been doing too badly at that particular line either. He's written a lot of songs, as you may know, for the Seekers, one for Anita Harris, even one for me at one time. Anyway, this song that I'd like to sing you now was in fact written when he was 9 years old, so it's world premiere, folks. I hope you like it. Here we go. I'd like to sing it for you now.
Oh, it ain't all Lanny and it ain't all Jem, walking round the houses with the feet. Not a bite to eat, traipsing around on me poor old feet. My old man, if I could find him in 99, would give. Poor old me, I haven't got a key and I don't know where I live.
Had a little studio in amongst my father's. He was a ham radio guy. We never ate dinner at the table because the table was covered in his stuff. He set up this little mic and we would broadcast to the next room with the neighbors in there. That's the closest my parents ever got to sort of being proud of us, overtly. I mean, I'm sure they were seriously proud of my brother and I, but they thought it was bad form to talk about it. So I always remember my mother was always like, sing up, Mary.
I know a fine way to treat a Steinway. I love to run my fingers for the keys, the ivory.
Yeah, well, I answered an ad in the stage that said Sister Act, established Sister Act, looking for to replace member or something like that. So I actually got the job. And it was, they were very nice girls, and it was really invaluable training. We did a lot of American air bases, made a couple of records on Fontana. Seven little girls sitting in a back seat. We had the second version of that. Actually, the third version of that. There was an American one, and the Avons had the hit, and we had the other one.
I believe from researchers that you actually went on tour with the Springboks.
I beg your pardon?
The Springboks!
Well, there were influences, but we were pseudo everything and we knew it. I mean, we just jumped up and down a lot and were cheerful, which was, there was a niche somewhere for cheerful people. And we were terribly out of tune. We just sang very fast and very cheerfully. And they gave us a TV series, would you believe? You know, we didn't have a record or anything, but that was the BBC for you.
Are we my way?
Hello, everybody. We'd just like to say how very happy we are to be with you on our own program. Well, the first song was a Zulu War tune with Tom on the bongo drum, Tim on guitar, and I'm Dusty.
I know something about love. Gotta want it back.
The exciters would have got you by the throat.
Go out and get him.
I first heard it briefly in New York. We had a stopover in New York, my first time ever. And I was going past a record shop, the Colony Record Shop, which was open until at least four, if not all night. And I just walked past. I mean, it was the thrill of being in New York, and it was nighttime, and the buildings were so huge. And it was like, who needed drugs? You know, it was just incredible. And I, out of the blue, come blasting out was, I know something about love. Come on, I did. That's it. That's what I want to do.
I
3 o'clock in the morning, wherever it is, Broadway or something or other. And I said, that's it. That's what I want to do. And we were going to Nashville to make a country album. So I, you know, took the scenic route to it.
And then you went solo, did you?
Yes, I did that.
Well done, Dusty.
Thanks.
We're all very, very proud of you.
Thanks.
You're an icon.
Oh, you make me cry. That's really
very
nice.
Nice. You're fabulous. We think you're fabulous.
I don't know what it is that makes me love you so. I only know I never want to let you go. Cause you started something, can't you see? That ever since we met you had a hold on me. It happens to be true. I only want to be with you, yeah. It doesn't matter where you go or what you do.
I remember that very well. But she had a wonderful, wonderful quality to her voice. You know, there are certain voices that you kind of latch on to immediately, and you know that they're going to be around for a long period of time. And she happens to have one of those kinds of voices.
It happens to be true. I only want to be with you, yeah.
I heard that and went, yes, we could do that, Ella, you know, with Phil Spector. Sound was the drum sounding like the household cavalry's going past, you know, I mean, as long as it was big mushy sound. But I mean, that again, that was a gift. I didn't ask for that song, it just came into my life.
Come on, it's worth a try. Go on, ask her.
We're just thinking, look, it would come here. It would just help the viewer at home if you put them on.
No. Honestly, I can't. First of all,
just
I never wore them that length.
Look at them. Just put them on.
And it's the wrong colour and the wrong shape.
Please.
No.
She doesn't want
anymore.
Stop trying to make Dusty put these on.
I won't.
Stop it.
I didn't.
She doesn't want to. You don't want to put
them on.
Stop it.
I'm not going to do it.
Lulu would.
I don't care.
It's your head. This was taken off your head in 1964.
A lot of French Vogue models had black eyelids. Not naturally, as far as I know. It was certainly help from little pots. And that was the look, but I never quite got it right.
Your face I see. Every step I take, you take with me. Yeah. Nowhere to run, baby. Nowhere to hide.
South Africa was a real muddle. I suppose I had ideals, but I also was politically very naive. I was naive in every way. And to my great surprise, the Musicians Union in England backed me up on having a clause written into the contract that I would not perform to segregated audiences. What the promoter had found was that you could indeed have mixed audiences if you played live music in a cinema, and it was a loophole.
Why did you have this special anti-apartheid clause written into your contract? Do you feel strongly politically about this?
No, I don't know the first thing about politics. All I know is that if... I think that there shouldn't be anybody, if they want to buy a ticket, should be allowed to do so. And this was the agreement I went under. And when, sorry.
Why was your contract different to previous ones? It was much stronger.
Well, I think that I may be wrong about this, but I think that in the case of most British artists who've been there before, they have played maybe one or two segregated concerts. And I didn't particularly want to do that.
In the end, they sort of drummed us out of the country, but they didn't deport us, because if they deport you, they have to pay your fares, you see. And what happened was that that loophole got closed. So I didn't do an ounce of good. But I didn't really go there to do good. I went there to sing, and I had
somewhere this kind of really naive ideal that that perhaps being there would make some form of difference. Well, it didn't. For a while, it made it worse. And I don't know whether to cry or laugh, because now I look back on it, was I the reason that that loophole was closed? Or all I did was make things worse.
Are you jealous of Cilla on Blind Date,
of her success?
No, not remotely. I can't do that kind of thing. I mean, she has that great quality. I can't do that kind of thing.
Is there possibly a game show for you in the pipeline?
That's a good idea.
I hope not.
That's a good idea, though.
No.
What would we call it? Dream Dusty Date?
No, I know. It needs to be something really, really plain, like Dusty, with an exclamation mark. Do you see?
Dusty dot 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 exclamation mark question mark.
Oh, absolutely.
Says it all.
I can see the posters.
You know, Dusty and I are such great friends. I'm only teasing. We just met
to me.
The show. I know, we have a little thing going, but we don't want to announce it immediately. Yes, it is. It was wonderful. I'm still tasting it.
Thanks for coming
on. A pleasure.
Bye-bye.
I did 2 years or 3 years for the BBC and one for ITV, I think. And they were fairly hectic, because I can't see cue cards. And besides, I don't think anyone had cue cards. I certainly didn't have autoprompters or anything. So, I mean, I had to learn it all. I spent half of the break, you know, the dinner break, when I was supposed to be putting the makeup on, running up and down to the sound booth, trying to get them to accept things like Jimi Hendrix's volume. They were just going ashen-faced when I went up there. You know? Everything had gone, the meters had totally gone. And going, that's the way it's supposed to sound. One of the nice things about doing those shows was I was just allowed to pick my own material. And as such, because I had a fairly eclectic taste in music, well, a very eclectic taste, thanks to my upbringing, I was able to sort of draw on that, and nobody thought it was odd. It was sort of just Dusty having a go.
When lagoon's dreams sing lullabies, there grows a young man there. The twilight gleam is in his eye. The light is on his hair. And like a lovesick lemon, he had my love is
Lord. I'm a happy knocker upper and I'm popular beside, cause I wake 'em with a cuppa and tasty mother's pride. Then they're off in a flash and a rush.
It's the bread.
And a dash and a push.
It's the bread.
With a flash and a dash and a rush and a push.
Like I said, it's the bread.
It's the mother's bright bread. It makes them love work. They're going berserk to get off to work. It's in the way I wake them by bringing to the side the bread we freshly bake them. Fantastic mother's pride.
close my eyes and count to ten. The thing I like about it most is I've tortured producers throughout my whole recording career trying to get the piano sound off that record. So it's as much the piano in the chorus that I always return to that song when I'm trying to convey what I think is the best piano sound that I can imagine, you know, is that booming, heavily compressed piano. But it's only because her voice over the top of it sounds so great. And it's no point for me to imitate her voice, you know, it just sounds silly. Just a certain thing in her voice, a little sort of, kind of like a reed or something. It's beautiful.
It's the way you make me feel the moment I'm close to you. It's a feeling so unreal, somehow I can't believe it's true. The pounding I feel in my heart, the hoping that we'll never part. I can't believe this is really happening to me. I close my eyes and count to 10, and when I open them, you're still here.
I wanted to get these sounds on a very, very limited equipment. And one of the things that drove me crazy about recording in that particular place was it was so dead. I mean, you'd sort of sing and the sound would start, oop, ha, like that. And I liked much more ambient sound and wilder sound. And so I used to record in the corridors mainly because there was some ambience to it. And the best was the Ladies' Loo. That was great. Much to the surprise of the cleaners one morning, about 6, I was doing Close My Eyes and Count to 10. I heard all this clanking down the end of the corridor, and they were standing there in their sort of print pinnies, going, what's she doing? It really was the best sound in there. It was a little echoey, and there was no control over it, but it gave it that sound. Because I had the most wonderful recording manager, Johnny France, who more or less used to let me do anything I wanted to. I know, I don't read, but I know when a chord's wrong, I know when a note's wrong, I know. But I wish I did read, because it's much quicker. I mean, that's where my recording manager came, would know. He'd go, it's a B flat you need. I'd have to sing it. That's the note that's wrong in the sax section. He'd just go, it's a B flat on the alto, which saved an awful lot of time. So we were a great team. I've never thought of myself as being a singer with an orchestra. I am part of the orchestra, part of the ensemble. I'm another instrument, and I like to be, that's why I like surround sound. I like to be part of it. So that's why I like Some of 11. And singing something off the wall like Poor Wayfaring Stranger, which I did on one of the early BBC shows.
I am a poor wayfaring stranger, wandering all this world of woe. And there's no sickness, toil, or danger in that bright land to which I go. I'm going.
That's a beautiful song. I am a poor, I can't sing anymore. Wayfaring Stranger, an old folk song that came from the Appalachians. It was probably originally Scottish. But I'm going home to see my father. It's so beautiful. I'm only going over Jordan, I'm only going over home. It's really a beautiful song. Murray the K did a show at the Brooklyn Fox, and most of it was the Motown acts, but he brought in a couple of English ones, and I did 10 days or 2 weeks. 6 shows a day, luckily only 2 or 3 songs.
Well, we were on the same show, and I got really elated when I could play her the acetate to Dancing in the Street. I didn't like the song at first, and I had to arrange the melody somewhat, because it was Marvin Gaye's song to start with. He, Ivy Hunter, and William Stevenson wrote the song. He sang something like, calling out around the world, are you ready for a brand new beat, baby? You know, he's got that style. So when I heard it, I said, oh, I could never sing it that way. And they said, well, give it a try. So they let me try my style of singing, and the second take was a keep. They kept the second taping of it. And I ran to Dusty with it, because we had been sharing things. She had told me how her record company was about to release some new things on her, and she was trying some different things. And we went crazy. We played it 3 or 4 times and danced all over the dressing room.
To me, Dancing in the Street was the epitome of the best record of its type I'd ever heard. I remember they played that, they had an acetate of it, Martha and the Vandellas, in the dressing room at the Brooklyn Fox. Again, like at 9:30 in the morning. And it takes an awful lot to make me enthusiastic at that time in the morning. And they put it on and I just fell over. It was the opening drum fill. Everything about it was right. It was like in your face. Fox, I mean, God, we started the first show at 10 in the morning, so instant laryngitis. I'm not good at that. It didn't seem to bother the other acts. It bothered me a lot. I probably had to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning in order to be together for it, you know. But the best part of that is the Mandellas of Martha and the Mandellas did the backup for Marvin Gaye from the Wings. And on the first show, there was always one who'd overslept, so wasn't there. So I got to be the third Vandello, and that, to this day, is the biggest thrill of my life. Hitchhack, hitchhack, baby. I just wanted to get on stage with him, but the moves were too swift for me.
Dusty was always in the Wings. I think she liked our music, and the reverse. I was always in the Wings because I liked her music. And we'd sing backup on the microphone for her on Wishing and Hoping. I guess that's what gave she and Vicki Wickham the idea to do a special and have us sing back with her.
Just wishing and hoping and thinking and praying, planning and dreaming, his kisses will start that won't get you into his heart.
I remember when Motown came over and did a special on Ready, Steady, Go, it was all very mysterious, this Tamla Motown label, and Dusty was one of the few singers that could sing any of those songs credibly. But when you see the show of her doing a Heatwave or whatever song it was, she's also, you know, encumbered somewhat by the rocking BBC band, you know. And the vocal is about the only thing that's real about it, you know.
Sweet.
So when Dusty and she invited us, well, they bring this new girls group over, the Supremes. But Barry had a plan to make them